strategize here, looking at it from all kind of ways. So when something happened, it don't surprise you. So when last week, when the dummy turned against the Iranian plan, right? The JOPOC, Joint Conference, whatever it is. The Iranians said, we're working on a strategy. We ain't working on no strategy. We knew it when he was going to do it. We talked about it here, and we was ready. We told them, you take us to Iran now, and we'll solve all your problems. So one of the Iranians last week, you know, the big shots, I said, you tell them to go on and do it. They didn't do it. But I said, let me ask you a question. I said, now, 35, 30 years ago, and all that, didn't we hit the nail on the head all over the world all the time with nobody telling us nothing? Yes. I said, well, why the hell do you think we can't do it now? I said, you tell them to take me over there and I'll stop the arguments between y'all and everybody will look good. Why? Because we've been thinking about it all along. And they've been in their narrow group. This is the deadliest thing for this time. Groupism. Iranians. That's why Iran got, we told them. We told Iranians, but they all was into groupism. Our shake, our pattern is going to save the world. That ain't the way it's going to work now. They ain't going to work like that. Anybody that's into groupism, they doomed. I mean, when I say groupism, that means our shake, our, we're going to save the world. You ain't going to save nothing. It's we, the world. And you gotta make room in the tent for everybody. That's what experience has taught us. I'll try to speed up a little bit. So, what's the name was right? Planning is everything. But so's a plan too. We have a goal. Planning mean we think about all this. Everybody's shocked. The foreign doing this. So that's your problem. We told you what they was gonna do. Okay. Now, as of today, here's our problem. Not our problem, our challenge. Truth, experience, correctness, historical sincerity. This is where the ayahs come in. Bring them to the, invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them in ways that are best and most gracious. For thy Lord knoweth best who have strayed from his path and who received guidance. These videos are going out, but this is not our particular line. This is in order to educate the movement. We have to educate the movement based on our real life discoveries. So we can't let public relations shave us away from what's happening by being too generous to the participants. I'll explain what I mean. Right here it says, and if you do punish, then punish with the like of that which you were afflicted. Okay. The niggas was trying to kill us and cut our throat. Ain't nobody been playing with us. Everybody, every group, they've been out to cut a nigga's throat. All of them. Every last one of them. Okay. But if you show patience, that is indeed the best course for those who are patient. Now, that's our principle. Remember, we have a dilemma. We have what we believe is the truth. We have experience. Well, survival is experience. We're not talking other than this because we're teaching now. When you're teaching a subject. We're not asking people, what do we think? We're teaching the subject. And it's open, anybody got a question, they can ask a question. But we're teaching this subject, how to survive under maximum attack of a system. How to do it. Nobody's done it before. No white group, nobody. Nobody, they haven't done it. That's because this is the time for us to evolve as a movement. Now, each evolutionary period or each phase, we will face challenges to see if we're going to remain true, right, to what we're about. That's why kindness, optimism, and humor, those are principles. Why? Because if you lose your humor, you treat niggas like they deserve to be treated. That way, treat them like dogs, because that's the way they've been acting. They cut every other nigga's throat throughout history, right? What was the old lady that freed the slave?
Harry Tubman.
She had to carry a pistol. You know what the pistol was for? It wasn't to shoot white folks. It was to shoot niggas. They want to go back. I want to go back to this is too hard. If you ask the Negro, do you want to be free? Most of it, if they answer truthfully, they say, absolutely not. I want job security. I want freedom. That means challenging the system. That means going the road less traveled. What? I know what happens up that road. It's the uphill road. That's what the Quran calls it. How many people you think want to go on the uphill road, baby? Just be serious. Literally nobody. People want job security. Well, if you want to die early, get job security. Get a job, like a lot of my relatives. Most of my relatives is house niggas. Educated, even in Arkansas, I was down there talking at the doggone family reunion. I was making fun of Bill. And my relatives, I was a younger man. They said, boy, don't you know we had one of our biggest family reunions at the State House in Little Rock? They house niggas professional. Judges, they're proud of it. My niece always called me, I hear him at the church, our such and such is a big judge in Arkansas. I said, that's good, that's good. He's a damn fool, but it's okay. He's a dumb judge. Who would want to be a judge in a criminal organization? It's like a mafia consigliere. If you're a consigliere, right? For the mafia, you're a criminal. If you're a judge in America, can you get justice in it? Okay, I don't want to go into that. I'm saying, here's what the Quran tells us. By the way, we talk about this because we've already passed that last test. The test whether we will become mean or whatever. The dummies in Oakland, I say dummies, they're real genuine dummies. They're gonna provoke you, they're gonna make you mad. So here's Mukhtar, the janitor. He's gonna stick his finger in my face and say, we're getting rid of you, we're putting you out of here. And the government give him all the wherewithal. A little while later, he can go to the bank, and the government give him my money. I go over here to Wells Fargo to open up a bank account for my Shell Islam. And they say, like somebody already told them, you can't use that because maybe we have to, they never said it before, we have to check and see who's has the authority. I say, here's all the people. Same thing with Citibank right down there. So you have to open an account in the slave name. So the United States government is thorough. We just sold for 25, 30, 40 million, whatever we like. We can't lose. It don't make no difference. The point is that when they give a dumb Negro authority, they give him authority to shoot you or anything else. I don't know other than the mosque, the Negroes is in front of the mosque, and Arabs with guns at high noon. This is a big deal. The Muslims don't care. The police don't care. In fact, when the police come and all them cars, they blocked the way so the other snitches could run away. And the white lady, not the white lady, but the black lady said, "Oh, then, why didn't come to your church with all them guns? And then the police blocked the way so they can all run off." I said, "Well, that's modern times, sister." I said, "That's the new Jim Crow laws for tattletales." Okay, now, by the way, all of this is documented. When I start making up stuff, everybody should jump up and holler. "And do thou be patient, for thy patience is but from Allah. Nor grieve over them, nor distress not thyself because of their plots." One of my partners, last year, he was number 3 in our organization. So we was talking about way back in the 70s when we was making a comeback. We had Africa, Europe, Scandinavia. Now we're making a comeback. So we go to Mexico, make a big purchase. Then I, with my partner, then I send him back to U.S. I go over to El Paso. But not El Paso. Juarez. And I tell a relative of mine to come, and I give him a big package of something. This is our startup. We're kicking back in the game now. But we're kicking not local, we're kicking global already. So my partner said that, "Oh, I buried it in the backyard, and it got all chewed up, you know, the thing." Well, my partner said that because in 1969, I told him when he was buying a big package, to buy a double package, bury one, and then later on, a few years later, when there was heat on us, I went to Terminal Island. I visited him. I said, "Where did you bury that package? Because see, when a lot of heat come on you, you can't, ain't nobody going to touch you. That thing is hot." So we knew life is going great. But does life continue like that forever? Let's examine it. No. Butch Cassidy and Sundance Kid, they robbed a lot of trains and then they had to go. Everybody we see, Bonnie and Clyde, I'm just saying what you knew about, you know. Bonnie and Clyde, they had a field day for a while, then they got knocked over. And everybody you see had a big run. Al Capone, then they go to the pen, right? So when it's rolling big, we buried. Just before leaving, we went and told us it's in Granny's backyard. I saw digging in Granny's backyard. "Who is that out there?" I said, "Oh, it's me, Granny. I'm digging up the dope." That was enough dope to get us overseas, to get us dug in deep with big money. Now, I don't mean to talk all this, but we have to understand. That's forethinking. And that's 50 years ago. If you got pre-thinking then, what are you going to have now when you got experience? That was just naturally doing that. It can't last forever. So let's build up for the bad time. Let's put something away for a rainy day. So when we kicked back off, my partner said, "Oh, I buried it like before and it got chewed up." I said, "Yeah, that was the start. I just drove right around. Set for some more money and started straight instead of Mexico, went on down to South America. Before long, we're the only Negro cartel in history that I know of. If anybody else has found one, that's good. What I'm trying to tell you is, whenever the parade was going by, we jumped in the parade.
we never observed spectators. You know, people watching life go by, spectators watching, watching the grade go by.
Anybody can do that if they want. That means you don't have no influence. You're watching a damn parade go by instead of getting in it. And if you get in it right, you can take the parade where you want to go. That's what we have to do. The world is not going the right place. It sounds arrogant, but the Negro got to take it the right way. You're going to be a little gangstified to do it. You can't sit around observing, monitoring. That don't work. Not this time. PR, our dilemma. How to deliver this product to the people with the best result. How we're going to tell the people this truth. That's what the Quran is doing right here. Bring them to the way of our Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching. That means we have to adjust the wisdom to what we're dealing with now. You know why? Nobody has reinterpreted these ayats for this time. Just like they didn't do it during the last period. So that means we have to be innovative. I don't want to sound talk gangster talk and now talk love talk. That is the key. But you think that love talk Jesus was talking was big, you're going to have to way outdo that. Turn the other cheekism, you're going to have to turn your behind inside out and upside down, because the Negro will stick his foot in your behind every time he got a chance. Because he's the white man's nigga. Remember, the niggas you see mostly are niggas developed by the white man. There are millions of people out there, some corrupted, some semi-corrupted, some waiting. This is the period in history. Every period in history, there's a group of people waiting. And when you come through with the word, bam, they said, that's it. That's what I've been waiting to hear. They're out there right now. All we have to do is get to them. Don't worry. The people they send to you, they the white man's nigga. Don't worry about them. That's why the ayah says, and do thou be patient, for thy patience is but from Allah. Nor grieve over them, and distress not thyself because of their plots. Don't worry about the coons and the bootlickers. They cannot help themselves. They don't know what you're talking about. They can speak the language, but you know what? There's a song in the universe, what's the name? The yogis say, there's a sound. But you know, there's a sound of freedom and everybody don't hear. That has a wealth sound and niggas don't hear it. If you give them the money, they'll throw it away because they don't hear that song. There's a song of freedom right now, freedom of new worldism. When the people, they're supposed to, when they hear it, they'll know that's what they wanted to hear. All we have to do is get the word out the best way we can. That's what these ayats mean. In the meantime, don't get spoiled, don't get hateful, but know how people are. That's the way they are. Don't sweat it. Don't sweat people, because the people are Quranic. You know what the Quran say about people? What is it? They say, you expect they're going to do just what the people do in the Quran. When Pharaoh tell them to do something, they're going to do it. Because they ain't all Pharaoh. And most people will bend to the will of the public. I have to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the mean old white man. The mean old white man, when we was kids and wasn't doing nothing, the white man sent us to prisons, the little kiddie jails, and we always went to the hole. And in the hole, you're by yourself. And you learn the secret. Love everybody else. help everybody else, but don't put your life in their hands, or you are a damn fool. You're a fool. But love them to death. But don't put your life in their hands. Don't put your money. I want to entrust this $50 million into your Negro hands. Good. You're a fool. But if you want to give him $50 million, give it to him. Say, here you go, bro. That's for you. I don't expect nothing from you. No thank yous, no hellos, no nothing. That's yours. And you get on about your business. But you don't give it to him expecting the movement, the world is depending on you. You be one sad joker. That's why it says don't worry about these blocks. If you do your part, you're going to be shocked about this new worldism. Could I digress? There happens to be one eye sitting right here in front of us. Inna Ibrahim Kana, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna Ibrahim Kana Umatan Kanitan Lillahi Hanifan Walam Yaku Min al-Mushrikeen. Abraham was indeed a model, says Umar. Inna Ibrahim Kana Umatan. Ibrahim was an ummah all by himself. That's exactly what it means in Arabic. Not just a model, but an ummah by himself. He was the only one pushing in the region. Monotheism by himself. He's a young guy. And that's the kind of movement we have to be. I've mentioned a few more things. If you ever wanted to have excitement in life, if you ever want to be where you're not bored, or depressed, jump on the white man. You don't have to worry about being bored. At first, it's a little scary, I'll tell you. 50 years ago, it was scary. The mean old white man taking all money, trying to send you to jail. You have your whole empire. It was something. But it ain't nothing now. That was when you're in your 20s and you're not learning. You do pretty good. You get to now, brothers and sisters, I'll close with these. How to do this in our time and under these conditions. That's our job. Guidelines, Quran, Sunnah, history, our experience. And another one we added is expectation. What you expect out of life. Remember the hadith? What Allah says, I, Allah, this hadith Qudsi, I, Allah, am to the believers what he expects of me. What do you pray for? A job. Fun. Pray for something big. You can't pray for nothing. If Allah gave each one of us seven heavens and earth like it exists right now, it wouldn't diminish Allah. If each one of us had that. So ask Allah for something. We expect nothing hardly from Allah, but what a job. Allah help me with a job. Well, what you think is going to overwork Allah, you ask for. Oh Allah, let's help us make a beautiful world, a world with peace and tranquility and some semblance of humanity. Right? Ask Allah for that. Ask Allah for something. And then ask him to leave the doors open of paradise where you can slide in. If you slide into paradise, boy, you done did a good job. Okay, reutilize that. This is planning.
Last thing I was talking to the kids today. You know, the news that kill the little children down there and stuff, so. When they had the demonstration, Fatima went over to me last month. And I told them, that's a dumb demonstration because the kids are demonstrating to get rid of guns. And you need more guns, not less guns. I said, it's not the Second Amendment, it's the First Amendment. All these movies and all this ignorance. Have you seen any movie where they solved any problem through intellectual struggle? It's the one with the biggest bomb and they blow a guy across the room and they shoot people in the head all day, right? So what is a dumb kid gonna do? If he asks a girlfriend, I like you, she says, I don't like you. He says, well, I'll just kill everybody. That's what everybody do on the movies, right? All the walking dead people, you shoot them and they come right back. You see all them people? My kids watch that stuff. I say, if you shoot a nigga with a shotgun, he's gonna die. These is 100 people, some kind of people, right? So that's stupid. But that's what people watch, right? That's people relate to. You know, we've been had guns. The Second Amendment is to protect yourself against the government. So the white folks is arranging at least the first shootings so they can take the guns from the other white folks. It's not the Second Amendment, it's the First Amendment, freedom of speech. The white folks making all these movies have to make a picture. Remember the old movies, how phony they was? You remember they would shoot a gun out of a guy's hand? Remember the old westerns? And stuff like that. They don't do that anymore. Violence. Okay, now, what I said was this. About Black Lives Matter, I said, niggas' life don't matter. You know, because ain't nothing happening. They've been shooting us all along, and niggas don't matter. Don't nobody do nothing about it, right?
No.
What do you mean? Well, this is terrible. I said, I don't never remember it not happening. And I was telling them, I said, y'all going to school to get your degree, but you'll find out one thing, not as bad as it used to be, but when you get a degree, they gonna call you a nigger. I said, the only difference between me and you and the Negro Esquire now is they call me a nigger and they call you Dr. And they treat me like a dog, and they treat you like a dog with shoes on. They thought that was funny. But it's true. And in closing, I said this the old story about the dog and the wolf. Oh, the old wolf was walking by, and he saw a dog behind the fence. Boy, that dog is coat was all fluffed up. You know what I mean? Puffed all up, hair cut and everything. You know what they do to dogs? They was a poodle or something. So the wolf, now the wolf got all kinds of little bugs all on him and stuff like that. He live out in the woods. And the wolf said, man, you got it good. And the dog said, man, I got it good. Shit, I got a little house over here. Man, I got meals and wheels, I got everything. So the wolf said, man, you put me up on that? He said, man, yeah, I'll put you up on it. You can get in this with me. So the wolf was getting ready to climb over the fence. And he said, by the way, what's that thing around your neck? He said, "Oh, that's a collar." He said, "Well, what does it do?" He said, "Oh, I got a boss man up in the house, and he put a little thing on the collar, and he'd take me around where he wanted me to go." So the wolf climbed back over the fence and went off in the woods, because the wolf was free. And that good fluffy coat, you know, niggas got fluffy coats. They all broke, you know, all the niggas driving them Benzes, they broke the fat coat. When they had the big problem here in D.C. 20 years ago, remember they was fined, all the niggas was living one paycheck above poverty. They was rolling. Them big Benzes, you'd stay down, whatever it is, Benning Road, or you stay on East Capitol, the Negroes coming in. Then they fired Marion Barry, they got the, what was that, the commission, Anthony Williams? What was that, the commission he had when he fired everybody? You know who Anthony Williams became mayor?
Control Board.
First is the Pro Board, then he become mayor. Then they said, "Oh, why, well, y'all can't have no more money." And all the niggas was flat broke. They looked good on the surface, but they didn't have no reserve. You know, the white man that hit us 7-8 times in a row and we ain't broke yet, that's rare. Usually they hit a nigga once or twice and he flat. They hit us in the gut. They hit us with precision munitions. The niggas around us tell them exactly. The family tell them exactly. This is where the nigga put it, this is where they got it. And the white man hit us exactly in that spot. There ain't nothing. So we're gonna be successful. We invite everybody to evolve. Take a chance. Learn how to live. I'm not being arrogant. But in the dunya, when we want to talk about somebody, we said, "Nigga, you need to get a job." It was a come down. Like all the work I do here, I had to learn it, because in the dunya, I wouldn't do no work. I'm a big nigga. The big nigga's fingers get his fingers done. They still love me, but I still let everybody else get their fingers done. Wearing them tight shoes and everything, your feet hurting and stuff. Yeah. But now life is different. Take a chance. You're gonna die anyway. I'll close with this. Think about it. Get your paycheck and you have your little house and it'll be paid for just before you die. You watch sports on Saturday, maybe. Stuff like that. And then you die. You never been to China? You never been to Mexico? You never had any influence on nothing. You were just in the mix and you just died. What the hell was you here for? And the one, the biggest troublemaker in the world is the one running everything. And you never go up against it. Everybody have a right to live their own life. Just for me, that's miserable as hell. That's the deadest life you can imagine. I go to work every day. I pay my bills. I have credit every 2 weeks, every year I go down to Florida. I go around the corner. You never notice people retire. They don't know what the hell to do. They don't do nothing. What was life about? Have a good time. Challenge the system. Make life something. Hey, man, say, you can't do nothing but get killed. You're going to die anyway. Suppose you get killed and die in 2020, or you die of natural causes in 2030 or 40. What the heck's the big difference? The Earth still got 4.5 billion years to go. And it's been here 4.5 billion years. Can you imagine? That makes you look very small, but very important. Thank you very much. Didn't mean to take all of this time, this wonderful month of Ramadan. Are there any questions or comments about anything that was said? Anything that needs to be clarified? Okay. I believe that everything I said was true. If you can think of anything, write it down and come back, and next time I give a talk at the end, say, Imam Musa, I think such and such, I did my research, and I found that such and such and such. So thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Is there any questions on there?
No.
No questions?
Yeah,
anybody watching it?
Oh yeah, a lot of you.
Oh, very good.